In this video in my Logisim series, I'll show the addition of floating point components to my CPU design and some nice programs I wrote using floating point. In order to do floating point in Logisim, I had to write a jar library. Here's a circuit I created to test all the components in my library. It shows all the mathematical functions as well as the floating point to integer conversion component and vice versa, and floating point pins, probes, and comparator. My library follows the IEEE 754 standard on representing floating point numbers. If you need a bit of a primer on this standard, I put together this short chart. It gave me a chance to get reacquainted with some nice features of the LaTeX document preparation system. For those interested, I put the LaTeX code for this chart at the end of this video. At any rate, it is not necessary to understand the IEEE 754 standard to enjoy this video. By the way, the not a number or NaN on the arcsine result, for example, is because you can never have an arcsine greater than 1, so basically a result does not exist. So let's get to my CPU. Notice the Y and A register floating point probes. Here's the new ALU including floating point components. I had to put in another selector bit line and make the MUX 32 input. And here's the new compare module, including floating point comparison. By the way, AR4 is the new ALU function selector bit I mentioned earlier. The control ROM had to be edited to include the new instructions. And here's the instruction list, including the new instructions. The design is now up to 100 instructions. An unfortunate aspect of the design is you can't specify a floating point number in immediate mode, such as with LODI. This is because in immediate mode, the Z register is specified as part of the instruction. But since the opcode takes up 8 bits, there are only 24 bits left for the Z register value. But single precision floating point numbers have to be 32 bits. So I put into my assembler the ability to assign a floating point value to a memory location or variable. I decided to use a tilde to indicate floating point. Let's see floating point in action, doing something useful and even fun. I created a program to do some function plots. It's getting cluttered, so let's clear the screen and continue. By the way, due to the length of some of the programs, I put the assembly language code for these programs near the end of this video. All these curves made me think of biorhythms, so I decided to write a biorhythm program for my CPU. Since for best results, I need to know the current date, I'll use my real-time clock version of my computer design. You can see the program grab the date. This uses a birth date of an actress, not my birth date. If you don't believe in biorhythms, and I'm not sure I do, it's still interesting to know how many days you've lived. Since the days lived takes some time to calculate, I store the result and use it for any subsequent plots rather than recomputing. Each biorhythm characteristic curve starts at 0 at birth and follows a different fixed period in days. In my plots, the current date is at the vertical line in the center of the screen. To the left is the previous 15 days, and to the right is the next 15 days. There are other lesser-known biorhythm curve sets, I Ching and secondary. Now for even better eye candy. I wrote a Mandelbrot and Julia fractal program. Since I knew it would take all day, I ran it on a different setup. This took 18 hours, and it's only half done. And that's just the quarter-size plot. Here's where the simulator I wrote comes in handy. I demonstrated this simulator in my previous video. Keep in mind, Logisim has a maximum clock of 4.1 kHz, and with a relatively large design such as this, you really won't even reach that speed, so that's why the Logisim version takes so long. And here's the quarter size one so you can see where the Logisim version was headed before I stopped it. And here's a raytracer I wrote for my design. For this Logisim demo, I chose to render a more interesting area of the scene, since I knew it would take a long time to calculate. The 16 rows of the scene took 19 hours. And this is what Logisim would have shown if I hadn't stopped it. Here's the full scene in full resolution. I programmed it to move the balls in different directions and move one of the lights to the left. By the way, the magenta ball is more specular or shiny than the other balls. The scene is getting darker because the brighter light is moving away. Since I wasn't, for lack of a better word, crazy enough to write recursion in assembly language with no hardware stack, especially for a 4.1 kHz clock, this ray tracer only traces primary and shadow rays, so there is no reflection or refraction. By the way, here's a new feature I put in my simulator, the ability to show the Y and A registers as floating point values. I also created a color cycling version of my fractal program. While the fractal is being computed, I store the iteration counts so I don't have to recompute the fractal when cycling the colors. Since the display component is true color and not indexed with a color table, the screen has to be completely redrawn to cycle the colors rather than just cycling the color table. You can see the keyboard controls used to change the direction and speed of the cycling. At this point, I should say that it is possible that this floating point design change might be taking my CPU further away from an FPGA implementation. VHDL and Verilog both support floating point variables, but to synthesize to an FPGA, you need a floating point IP core. Probably most commercial synthesis packages have floating point cores available, and there's also open source cores at opencores.org and other places. But they probably won't contain all the math functions such as arcsine and natural log. Here's the function plotter source code. By the way, I gave the floating point instructions a slightly different yellow color in Notepad++ to make it a little easier to tell the difference. It would be bad to accidentally use integer functions on floating point variables and vice versa, except of course using the provided conversion functions and the Biorhythm source code. Sorry for the lack of comments. It's a simple algorithm, but rather laborious in assembly. And the fractal source code, with C code in the comments. And the ray tracer. But first, here's a LaTeX chart I put together to explain the illumination model I use in my C ray tracer compared to the simpler model used in this assembly version. And for those curious, here's the LaTeX files for the charts. Well, I think this design change is a real paradigm shift. One can now create much more useful programs.